हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक। माई सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो टुडे यू विल हैव द 11th ऑफ फेब्रुवरी 2021 एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर करंट अफेयर्स। सो यू मस्ट अंडरस्टैंड दैट द करंट अफेयर्स हैज ह्यूज वेटेज इन योर वेरियस गवर्नमेंट कॉम्पिटेटिव एग्जामिनेशंस, ऑल्सो इन द यूपीएससी सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन विच इज कंडक्टेड बाई द यूपीएससी। सो For those students who are preparing for the civil services examination conducted by the UPSC, you have to read the daily current affairs as well as you have to read national newspaper also. So for those students who are preparing for those civil services as well as reading the newspaper, you can also subscribe our channel Future IAS and you will get the daily current affairs on day-to-day basis. So today we are going to start with our 11th February current affairs. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. All right, so first is Major Port Authority Bill 2020. Okay, so the news basically flashing out is related to the Major Port Authority Bill 2020, which was passed by the parliament. Okay, now the procedure for passing the bill is that the bill will pass in one house, then another house. The same house which passed the bill will send this bill to the another house. The another house will consider this bill, okay, and will pass this bill, okay. And then when the parliament is both the houses of the parliament, when both the houses of the parliament passes the bill ultimately goes to the president for their assent or for his assent. Once the president assented to the bill become act. So unless the president assented to the bill or unless the president gives his assent, the bill will never considered as a act. So still it is considered as a bill. Once the president gives his assent, it will be considered as a act. Okay. So let's understand about the salient features of the Major Port Authorities Bill 2020, which was passed by the parliament. Okay. So first of all, a previous bill which was there, the Major Port Trust Act 1963. If you compare with this bill, Major Port Authority Bill 2020 with Major Port Trust Act 1963, comparatively, this bill is comparatively more smaller and compact. Okay, so why it has emerged as a compact and a smaller bill? Because the government of India has basically, you know, deleted certain obsolete sections, certain redundant sections which are of no use, right? Certain other sections which have been merged, right? So it has been shortened away by deleting certain sections or eliminating those sections which are having overlapping, you know, areas or overlapping jurisdictions. So which has made this bill more compact, more smaller comparative to the previous Major Port Act 1963. So you can consider this bill, the bill will have 76 sections only. Okay, so number of sections in the bill is only 76. In the Major Port Trust Act 1963, the number of sections were 134. Okay, so from 134, it has reduced to 76. Almost half of the sections have been deleted or eliminated. All right. Then the bill has proposed simplified composition of Board of Port Authority. So there is a Board of Port Authority, right, which will basically administer, right, the basically port. So here the Board of the Port Authority, which was previously also there under Major Port Act 1963. Now the members consisting of that board has also been reduced comparative to the previous, right, previous Major Port Act. So now members will consisting of only 11 to 13 members, right, from the present, which is having 17 to 19 members. So this shortening of the members or number of members have been reduced. This will help, you know, to take the decisions much faster, much speedily, and it also cut down certain bureaucratic and certain red tapism in the board level. All right, then a role of tariff authority for the major post, that is called TAM. So the role for tariff authority for the major post have been redefined, or it has been, you know, enhanced. The role for the tariff authority have been enhanced. So now the tariff authority have been given the power to fix tariff. Tariff means it is something which is basically charged by an authority if any other person or any other, you know, agency basically utilize its, you know, certain aspects. So now this tariff authority will basically fix the tariff, okay, and that tariff will act as a reference tariff. Okay, for example, if any concessionary comes or if any, you know, private sector or private operator comes, right, for, you know, for commencing any project or for executing any project, obviously, you need to, first of all, bid, right? Bidding is the process by which you generally award a particular project to, you know, the concessionaire who were basically quoted the lowest amount of bid, right? So here the bidding process will be done through which you will be selecting the bidder who has quoted the least price, right? Which will be beneficial for the client also, right? So here the bidding process will be there. And for the purpose of the bidding process, a reference tariff have been made by the, reference tariff will be made, right? As a tariff which was fixed by the tariff authority for the major ports. Okay, and also the PPP operators, PPP means public-private partnership operators who are working in the major ports, right, for various, you know, manufacturing, construction activities or various other activities, they will be free to fix tariff based, which is based on the market conditions. So now you can say that the first of all, the tariff authority's role is just to fix a reference tariff. That's all. Remaining to fix certain set of tariff which will be based on the market conditions. Now the PPP operators have been given the power for that. Okay. Then the Board of Port Authority have been delegated certain more powers, right, to fix a scale of rates for other port services as well as assets, including the land. Okay. So the power to fix the scale of the rates, on what rates the certain other services and assets will be given to concessionary, will also be decided by this board, right? And whatever is left out, right, whatever is left out or residual, you know, functions which have not been covered, right, either by the TEMP or tariff authority for the major port, right, or by the board. So any other function which is not covered by the TEMP or tariff authority for the major port, such functions will be, you know, will be given to an adjudicatory board. This adjudicatory board will be created under this, you know, bill 2020, and this adjudicatory bill will basically take care of remaining, you know, residual functions which were previously, you know, taken care by tariff authority for the major ports, right? For example, if there is a dispute between the port and PPP concessionary, right? So for that disputes, a adjudicatory board will be taken care, right, which was previously given to the TEMP for the major ports. All right. Then a board for the port authority have been delegated full power. So a board of port authority will be delegated a full power, right, for entering into the contract, right, for planning, for development, for fixing of tariff, right, except in the, just in the 3 and 4 conditions, right? So first condition is the national interest, second is security, and third is emergency. So these are only 3 instances. Except those 3 instances, the board of port authority have been delegated all powers or full powers to enter into contracts. But under previously the Major Port Trust Act 1963, right, the basically, you know, the board of the port authority required to take the approval from the central government, right, in the case of 22 such instances. And 22 such instances, few of them like national interest, security, and the, you know, emergency, right? So all such, you know, additional instances which were deleted, now these, for those instances, there is no need to take the approval of the central government. Now the board of port authority will have all powers to enter into the contract planning and the development related to any sort of a project within the major port region, right? And the board of each major port shall be entitled to create a specific master plan, right? For example, if there is a, for example, you know, the NPT, right, port, or, you know, any sort of a major port, the board of the major port will be creating its own master plan. And based on the master plan, basically, you know, the developmental work or infrastructural work will be carried out. So that will be good. That will be good in terms of providing, you know, the developmental opportunities, infrastructural development in the port region, as well as the provisions of, you know, CSR and the development of infrastructure by the port authority have been introduced. So the CSR provisions as well as the infrastructural development provisions by the port authority have been introduced, right? And also there is also provisions have been made for safeguarding this pay and allowances and the service conditions, including the pensionary benefits of the employees of the major ports. So whatever the employees which are working in the major port region, certain provisions have been made so that the pay allowances, service conditions of those workers should not be hampered or should not be restricted because of such changes, right? So including the pensionary will not get be affected because of any such change which have been made through the bill 2020. Okay, next, the Ambedkar Social Innovation and the Incubation Mission. So what is that Ambedkar Social Innovation and the Incubation Mission? First of all, you must understand, it is basically, you know, the mission was implemented by the Ministry of Social Justice and the Empowerment, Government of India, which has launched this mission. And this mission is basically, you know, giving certain venture capital fund for the scheduled caste. Okay, so this mission, right, was launched under the venture capital fund for the scheduled caste on 30 September 2020. The ultimate purpose of this Ambedkar Social Innovation and Incubation Mission is to boost entrepreneurship and the innovation among the SC students and SC Dibyang youths. So those who are physically disabled, right? So because you must understand, all of the entrepreneur or, you know, business persons are basically, majority of them are not scheduled caste or scheduled tribe. So to boost the zeal among the scheduled caste students, among the scheduled caste, you know, disabled people, such mission was launched by the Ministry of Social Justice so that it can boost the entrepreneurship's, you know, zeal among the scheduled caste students, as well as the innovation zeal among the scheduled caste students. Okay, now those companies and the entrepreneur which are owned by the scheduled caste, right, they should be, you know, registered as a technology business incubators. These technology business incubators, right, for entrepreneurship, they will be eligible to get a capital, right? So they will be eligible to get the capital for funding, right, of their project that is called technology business incubator. So they will be getting the maximum capital of 30 lakhs over the period of 3 years, 10 years lakh per year. So for the 3 years, they will be eligible to get a maximum of 30 lakhs, right, that will be given in the, you know, in the range of 10 lakhs per year. Then the financial support up to 10 lakhs per year will be given for a period of 3 years, right? And that should not be exceeding 30 lakhs per 3 years. So it should be provided only to the eligible applicants who are registered as a technology business incubators and who should belongs to the scheduled caste. Obviously, those are eligible entrepreneur, and those are belong to the scheduled caste, and those who are registered as a technology business incubators, only for them such financial support will be provided. Okay, so through this diagram, you can see the Ambedkar Social Innovation Incubation Mission. So first of all, to promote entrepreneurship zeal among the SC youth. So obviously the SC youths are not having that much zeal to basically having that entrepreneurship mind, right? To promote further entrepreneurship, a special funding mechanism have been made with a special reference will be given to the Dibyangs or the disabled persons among the SC students. Okay. And here the technology business incubators would be set up. These technology business incubators would basically set up by the Department of Science and Technology, and that will basically support, you know, around 1000 innovative ideas, right, through these technology business innovatives. So that will further boost an ecosystem for the startups, right, as well as the entrepreneurship in our country. The next is basically support. The government will support, promote and handhold startup ideas till they reach the commercial stage by providing liberal equity support. So here the government will provide the equity support to those, you know, scheduled caste people or to those entrepreneurs, right, who belongs to the scheduled caste and who have set the technology business incubators, so that these funding will support, promote and handle up to only that level that they reach to the commercial stage. Once they reach to the commercial stage, there is no need to support them. They will themselves can propel their own technology business incubators, right? And then next, the incentivize the students with innovative mindset and to take entrepreneurship with the confidence. So next is basically the government through this funding mechanism will be providing, right, certain set of incentives, right, to those students who are having innovative mindset, right, so that they can take up this entrepreneurship zeal with much confidence. All right. Then migrants labor, the issues related to migrants labor. There are a lot of issues related to the migrants labors, right? Recently, the labor died because of, you know, overrun by the truck in the Gujarat region, right? So here, what is happening is that the laborers are basically facing a lot of problems since they are migrating continuously. So they don't have, first of all, their identity assertion, right, where they can prove their identity and they can get the benefit from the government. So first of all, their identity related problems are there, where it is very difficult for them to ascertain their identity. So they are facing a lot of problems in terms of the food, in terms of their, you know, their accommodation, in terms of other, you know, related aspects of the development, in terms of they are not getting, you know, the potable water, right, the proper place to stay, all sort of the things they are facing. So now, for resolving such issues, the Niti Aayog has constituted a subgroup to prepare a national action plan for the migrant laborers, right? So such national action plan for the migrant labor would definitely help the migrant labor to remove or to, you know, to resolve certain issues related to the migrant labor. So here, this subgroup, which was, you know, constituted by the Niti Aayog, would consisting of the members. These members basically belongs to the ministries of the government of India, right? Certain other subject experts also will be included in this subgroup, as well as the NGOs who are working for the upliftment, for promotion of the interests of the migrants will also be involved. Civil society organizations will also be involved who are working for the migrant laborers, right? And these subgroup basically prepare a tangible action plan in the form of national action plan to address the issues related to the migrant labor, right? And there is obviously through this national action plan, the government is trying, or Niti Aayog is trying, to promote the interest of the migrant labor. Okay, for that, the central government has already enacted the Interstate Migrant Workmen Regulation of the Employment and Conditions of the Service Act 1979. But there are certain flaws with respect to this act of 1979. And now government is, you know, further focusing on, you know, the welfare of those migrants labor, which are facing currently certain other issues related to the contemporary issues. Now, the next code is basically OSH code. OSH means Occupational Safety and Health Code, right? Which is also related to the migrants. So here what is happening is that this act is now being subsumed in the Occupational Safety and Health and the Working Condition Code 2020, right? This code was already notified in 29/9/2020. This code is basically addressing certain issues related to the migrants or related to, you know, certain workers who are considered as a migrants. For example, obviously the name itself says occupational safety, health and the working conditions. So it is related to the safety related aspects, health related aspects, as well as the working conditions related aspects. So here, right, this code provides the decent working conditions to the workers. The minimum wage will be provided to the workers. The grievance redressal mechanism, if at all there is any grievances, right, with the workers, obviously that will have certain set of redressal mechanism. Then protection from the abuse and the exploitation. The workers should be protected from any sort of abuse and exploitation, right? Simultaneously, certain mechanisms to enhance the skills of the workers, right? The workers should be provided certain social security, right, in all sort of organized and unorganized workers, including the migrant workers. So this Occupational Safety, Health and Working Condition Code provide all such avenues for the welfare of the migrant workers, as well as other category of organized and unorganized workers, right? And here the relevant provisions of the code are basically applicable to every establishment, right, which is having 10 or more interstate, you know, migrant workers. So all such establishment where the 10 or more migrant workers are basically employed, such code will be applicable to those, you know, enterprises. Next, the word pulse day. Pulse, you know, there are pulse which are, you know, rich in terms of protein and other, you know, nutrients. So the Union Agriculture Minister basically, you know, will act as a chief guest on the word pulse day. So first of all, the word pulse day is celebrated on the 10th of February every year. So the Union Agriculture Minister basically readily, you know, accepted the honor which was provided as a chief guest on the World Pulse Day. So here, the UN General Assembly in 2019, right, decided that a day will be dedicated, right, for the promotion of the pulse, right, to increase the awareness related to the pulse, right, so that the average pulse consumption among the people should be increased, right, because it has certain inherent benefits. So for that, you know, also to access the pulses globally, right, a day was decided, the 10th of February of every year, the World Pulse Day will be celebrated. It will recognize pulse as a global food, right, so that it can basically help in the distribution and procurement of pulse among the countries of the world, right? So here on the World Pulse Day, the people will make an effort of creating awareness about the importance of the pulse. That pulse is basically in the form of sustainable food production, right? And the UN General Assembly, after recognizing the values of the pulse in 2013, already, you know, adopted 2016 as an international year of the pulse to further boost the production, productivity, and basically the availability of the pulse throughout the world, right? World Pulse Day 2021 theme this year was the Love Pulse, hashtag Love Pulse, which was basically again, you know, given by the World Pulse Day, given on the World Pulse Day by the United Nations General Assembly. All right. Next, Brahmaputra Valley Fertilizer Corporation Limited. So first of all, Brahmaputra Valley Fertilizer Corporation Limited is basically a public sector undertaking. It is located in the Assam, in the Namrup region of Assam. Okay. It generally produces the urea manufacturing, right? Or urea fertilizer. So it is basically manufacture or produces the urea as a fertilizer. Now what is happening is that, you know, there are certain issues related to the funding of the Brahmaputra Valley Fertilizers and Corporation Limited. Now this fertilizer which is produced as a urea is basically distributed to the farmers, right, in the northeastern region, right? And the distribution of the urea basically on the subsidized rate. Now, what is happening is that the Brahmaputra Valley Fertilizer Corporation Limited is facing a lot of financial upheavals, right, to continue their operations for the manufacturing of urea in their two plants. Now, the cabinet, now what happens is, because of this financial problems, the Department of Fertilizer have asked, right, the Cabinet Committee on the Economic Affairs to approve a grant in aid of around 100 crore rupees to the Brahmaputra Valley Fertilizers Corporation Limited. Now, the Cabinet Committee on the Economic Affairs has accepted this proposal of feeding the grant in aid of around 100 crore rupees to Brahmaputra Valley and Fertilizers Limited, right, to the Namrup, Assam, that will sustain the operations of the production of urea in this plant. Now, the BVFCL, which is the Brahmaputra Valley Fertilizers Corporation Limited, it is basically a public sector undertaking, which is basically formed as per Company Act. This BBFPL comes under the administrative control of Department of Fertilizers under Government of India. Okay. Now, at present, what is happening is that this plant have, you know, two vintage plants. Vintage means they are very old and they are named as Namrup 2nd and Namrup 3rd. Both of these plants are vintage, right? And they are basically producing the urea in their premises. Okay. Now they are facing financial difficulty. To further, you know, boost this 100 crore rupees will restore the urea production in this the plant of BVFCL. This plant has the capacity of 3.90 lakh million tons per annum of the production of urea, and that will help in the timely availability of the urea, especially in the northeastern region, especially to the tea farmers, right, as well as the other farming community who are basically there in the northeastern region. All right. So it is basically the Brahmaputra Valley Fertilizer Corporation Limited. Okay. Next is Koo App. So what is that Koo App? Koo App is basically, you know, it is basically, homemade version of social networking platform. So Now, what is happening is that this Koo app was promoted by the government of India itself. It won the award, right? So now what is happening is that there are issues related to other social networking platform. For example, recently the Twitter is facing a lot of problems in terms of, you know, the inciting, you know, certain offenses or providing the misinformation or provocating content, right? And because of that, you know, farmers are further agitating, right? So the government basically asked the Twitter to suspend or block as many as 1200 such accounts so that, you know, it can contain further, you know, growing or the growth of, you know, any sort of the violence which is going on due to the farmers' protest, because this Twitter accounts basically provide the misinformation and certain content which may provocate or which may provoke certain, elements and which can cause further, you know, violence in the Delhi region. So the government has asked the Twitter to immediately suspend or block those accounts. Now, what is happening is that the union government and the several ministries basically now started using this Koo app. Okay, this Koo app is also the social networking site, but it is basically homegrown. That means it is made up of by the Indians, right? So it is a micro blogging site. It is founded by the two entrepreneurs. One is Radhakrishnan and second is basically Mayank. So Mayank and Radhakrishnan both founded this micro blogging site as a social networking platform. And previously, the Radhakrishnan also founded a cab booking service that was online cab booking service known as the Taxi for Sure. But what happens is the Ola has taken over this, you know, Taxi for Sure subsequently. And now the Radhakrishnan has formed this app, which is known as Koo app. Now, though the Koo app was already launched in early 2020, but what happens is it won the government's Atmanirbhar app innovation challenge, which was organized by the government of India. So this Koo app has won the Atmanirbhar app innovation challenge, and which has further led to the promotion of this Koo app, right? So because of that, it comes in the limelight of uses of this Koo app. Okay, now this app along with other India made apps like Zoho and Chingari, right? The Chingari is basically local version of TikTok. Now TikTok was banned by the government of India also, right? These apps have been promoted by the government of India under the Atmanirbhar App Innovation Challenge in order to contain the growth of certain apps which are basically originated from the China. Okay, so there are scores of the apps which are originated from the China and which is having basically certain national security concern, right? So to remove the national security concerns, right, government of India is also promoting certain apps which are homegrown. Okay. And though they are also winning, you know, Atmanirbhar App Innovation Challenge, obviously, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi also used, the Koo app in his Mann Ki Baat address also, so that it can further promote this app. Okay, so it is basically a Koo app. So you can basically download from your, you know, the Google Play Store and you can use it. Okay, next is UAE Hope Mission. So this was basically the United Arab Emirates. The United Arab Emirates basically, you know, has sent his first mission to the Mars. Okay. Basically, the mission basically entered the orbit of Red Planet, which is also known as Mars. Okay. And this is also known as Hope Probe, right? Which was basically launched from the Japan or from Tangeshima in the Japan region. So it is the first such probe that was launched by United Arab Emirates, right, which has entered into the orbit of Mars. So the UAE or United Arab Emirates have become, you know, or have joined the club of the countries which have already, achieved this mission of entering into the orbit of Red Planet. And those countries are basically USA, Russia, China, European Union, and India. So five countries currently have entered into this, this union. Now this UAE would be the sixth country which has joined, right, in the allied group of countries which has basically sent their mission to the orbit of Mars. Okay, it is basically an unmanned aircraft which is also known as Al Amal. Means, for the Arabic word, it means hope. Okay, so Al Amal means hope. So why this date have been chosen? First of all, you must understand this historic, the time which was chosen is basically as a 50th anniversary of unification of UAE seven Emirates. So in the UAE, you have seven Emirates, and it is celebrating the fifth anniversary of, you know, unification of those seven Emirates within the UAE. And for that significance, a historic event of setting up of this mission, which was sent to the Red Planet, have been commissioned. Okay, this, you know, mission was first announced in 2014. Since then, the work for the Mars mission have been, you know, continuously working on. Now, this, you know, Mars mission have been developed and operated by the Mohammed bin Rashid Space Center in the UAE, right? This Mohammed bin Rashid Space Center basically collaborates with the University of California, Berkeley University, as well as the Arizona State University of the USA, as well as it is also collaborating with the University of Colorado Boulder in the United States. Okay. And in July 2020, this mission have been launched from Tanegashima Space Center in the Japan, and it has been carried on basically a Japanese made rocket, which was known as the Mitsubishi Heavy Industries H2A rocket, which basically took this, you know, Mars mission, or the satellite, you can say, basically to the Mars, or to the orbit of the Mars. All right. And this has been successfully, you know, entered into the orbit of Mars. Okay. This mission basically carries three instruments. The first is basically high resolution camera, which will take the pics of the Mars. Okay. The surface of the Mars, and then the surface in the environment of the Mars, as well as it will send those pics, right, back to the Earth. It will also have the spectrometer. It will also have, you know, certain spacecraft, right, which can basically having to collect the data on the maritime climatic dynamics, right, so that the scientists on the Earth can understand the Mars atmosphere, right, which is decaying into the space, right. The hope is basically the UAE fourth space mission, right, and it is the first interplanetary mission, right, which was first sent to the Mars. Right, the previously three such space missions are only related to the Earth observation satellites. So this is the fourth such mission which was interplanetary in the nature. Okay, and the life of such mission is basically 681 days. 681 days is basically one Martian year on the surface of Mars. Right, so 687 days, that means it, the Mars basically completes one revolution, right, in around 681 days. So the life of this mission is also 681 days. Okay, the privatization of the banks. Okay, this is basically, again, the budget 2021, right, has given, you know, announcement related to the privatization of two public sector banks, right, in addition to the IDBI, and also one general insurance company in the upcoming fiscal. So the government is planning to, right, to privatize certain banks in the upcoming fiscal. Okay, so government has already announced the policy through the budget that the government will undertake the strategic sale and the disinvestment policy, okay, especially in the four strategic sectors. These strategic sectors, which was announced by the government through the budgets, are the banking sector, insurance sector, and the financial sector. So for the general insurance company, it is basically from the general insurance. From the finance sector, some other, you know, company will be taken over. So here, the banking, insurance, and the financial services, these sectors will be either strategically sold or disinvested, right, to the private sector. And in 2015, the government already mooted this idea, but it was defeated because of, on that time, the RBI governor Raghuram Rajan did not accept this version of, basically the strategic sale or the disinvestment policy related to the banking, insurance, and the financial services in India. Okay, now why this argument, which are, you know, cited for the privatization? First of all, what are the supportive arguments? First of all, you know, the government is continuously injecting, you know, lot of funds. Government is also doing certain reforms also, but despite of these, you know, injecting of, you know, crores of the rupees into the banking system, into the finance system, into the insurance system, right, despite of that reforms also, the government is not able to improve the financial position of the banking sector. So that is also the primary reason that if these reforms and capital injections are not able to, you know, improve the conditions, let them, you know, either, you know, the strategically sold out to the private sector. Okay. Now, if you compare with the private sector banks, right? So the private sector banks having comparatively lesser amount of stress assets. Stress assets are those assets which have not been repaid back, or their interest have not been repaid back. So if you compare with the private sector banks as well as the government sector banks, the number of stress, you know, assets have far exceeded in the public sector banks than the private sector banks. Okay. And also the public sector banks also lacks in terms of profitability, in terms of market capitalization, and in terms of dividend payment record. So there is, you know, obviously the, you know, in the loser side. And government is already, you know, pumped a lot of money, even crores of the money into the government run banks. For example, 70,000 crore rupees had already pumped in September 2019 in the banking system. In financial year 2018, 80,000 crore rupees have been pumped. And in financial year 2019, 1.06 lakh crore rupees have been pumped into the financial system through the recapitalization of the bonds. So which has not been further, you know, able to, you know, improve the position of the banking system. Now in 2019, you might be aware about that the government has already merged the 10 PSU banks into the four. Okay, so already 10 PSU banks were there. They were basically merged into the four such PSUs. Okay, if you compare with the private sector banks again, the market share of the loans which has increased to the private banks, for example, it has, you know, risen to 36% in 2020 from 21.26% in 2015. So the market share related to the private sector banks, okay, have increased from 21.26% to 36% from 2015 to 2020. The same has decreases in the private sector banks. It has fallen down from 74.28% from 2015 to 59.8% in 2020. So this also shows that the people has started, using the private sector banks, or also started believing the private sector banks, right? The people has the confidence on the private sector banks also. Next, the Koch Rajbangis, right? These are basically the people or inhabitants of the Assam, West Bengal, right? And the Bihar regions of India. Okay. Now what is happening is that there is legislative assembly elections in the West Bengal. So the election related, the activities have increased. Now the Union Home Minister Amisa, will visit the Assam region and the West Bengal region, where a community called Koch Rajbangis will be there. Okay, this community will have the vital assets in the hands of BJP, right, which can get, certain benefit out of the Koch Rajbangis from the Assam and the West Bengal region, because they were also rulers of this region also. Okay, now the community which we call the Koch Rajbangis, basically they have their trace in their roots basically in the Kamata kingdom. This Kamata kingdom basically, once upon a time, it was consisting of the parts of Assam, West Bengal and the adjoining territories. Okay, in the medieval period of the time, right, this territory which consisting of the Kamata kingdom, this was also known as the territory of Kamatpur. This Kamatpur territory basically consisting of the large part of West Bengal, right, Bangladesh, Bihar and India's northeastern region, especially, the Assam and adjoining West Bengal. Now what happens is, after independence, there was a princely state known as Koch Bihar. This Koch Bihar was basically also, inhabited by this Koch Rajbangis, which were basically become a part of West Bengal. Now, today, this Koch Rajbangis basically are found in Assam and the West Bengal, as well as adjoining regions. For example, this Koch Rajbangis are found basically in the Assam, Meghalaya, West Bengal and the Bihar region, right? They are also found in the Bangladesh, Nepal and the some parts of Bhutan. In terms of their number, they are estimated of around 33 lakh people in the West Bengal. They are mostly found in the northern district of West Bengal. And these people are also having significant larger number in the Assam state also. So you can see the picture of Koch Rajbangis. Okay, next is NSE co-location case. Now what happens is, there is, capital market regulator that is called Security and Exchange Board of India, who has put a penalty of 1 crore rupees on the National Stock Exchange, right, in the NSE co-location case. Okay, so after investigation, it was found that it was found that, you know, a certain faster access was provided, right, to certain users or to certain brokers, which have given a preferential treatment, which have given the preferential access to the facility in the basically National Stock Exchange, and which has basically led to the preferential benefit which was given to those brokers. So now the allegations which was first erupted in the form that some of the brokers have given the preferential access, right, through the facility in the stock exchange, right, which are in the form of early logging, and you will get basically, you know, a split second faster access, and that you will able to get the data feed related to exchange, and you will get benefited out of it. Okay, now even if a split second, you know, faster access if you provide it, right, obviously those brokers have got huge gains of the profit related to the, you know, stock exchange. Now the few brokers which was given the, you know, entry or, you know, preferential access has now led to, you know, login into the NSE system with their better hardware system, and which has led to the unfair access and the advantage which was provided to those, you know, brokers. This unfair access issues pertain to 2012 and 2014, when NSE or National Stock Exchange basically used to disseminate price information system through a unicast system. Through that system, the unfair access in terms of the split second earlier have been given to certain brokers, which has led to the entry of those brokers into the exchange, and which has led to the preferential treatment and early information related to the brokerage, and which has led to the significant amount of profit to those brokers. Okay, so thank you very much. That's all for the today. We'll meet again for tomorrow, our daily current affairs. So till then, thank you very much.